Welcome also to those people who are following us on the webcast. It's a fantastic ability to reach not only the people based here in Nairobi, but also those who are able to watch on the website. Now, I think it's important before we move into the substance of the session to just think a little bit about the context for these discussions. Now, climate change is likely to intensify the many challenges that governments face in implementing the 2030 agenda, such as the new Sustainable Development Goal, which focuses on ending hunger and malnutrition. That's goal number two, second only to the goal on ending poverty. Now, we all know that more equitable, sustainable, and efficient global markets for agriculture and fisheries products are going to be key to achieving the ambition in the 2030 agenda. And that's reflected, I think, in the title of our session. What is it that we can do to move towards more equitable, sustainable, and efficient global markets for agriculture and fisheries products? Now, it's also no surprise to any of you that achieving WTO disciplines in these areas in the last few years has been quite a challenge. Progress has been incremental at best. And in part, this is probably a reflection of the centrality of markets for food and agriculture in contributing to issues that are as politically important and sensitive as food security and nutrition. This means that public goals and progress in public policy around these areas have been seen as being particularly controversial by market actors and also by governments in key countries. Now, in the lead up to MC10, we saw that progress on specific negotiating topics like export subsidies has been largely overshadowed by very deep-seated disagreement in the WTO about the way to move forward, with talks on trade at a global level, and not least, the fate of the Doha round. But whatever the outcome at Nairobi, many observers anticipate that the WTO will afterwards enter into a sort of a period of reflection about how best to respond to some of these global challenges. The E15 is particularly well-placed, we think, to provide a response to this growing demand for thoughtful responses and new directions in the years ahead. And this session in particular is designed to explore how markets, policies, and global rules are evolving, and to discuss the policy options identified in the E15 initiative by groups, expert groups on agriculture and fisheries, and how those are relevant to the WTO agenda. Now, I'm joined by a group of panelists, an exceptionally large group of panelists, which explains why I'm standing up, who are going to present the policy options defined in the group on agriculture and the policy options defined in the group on oceans and fisheries, and then to discuss what the implications of these might be for the WTO. So starting at my right, your left, Dr. Eugenio Diaz Bonilla is a visiting senior research fellow at the International Food Policy Research Institute, and he'll be talking to us about the E15 expert group on agriculture and the policy options that they've developed. Next is Rashid Sumaila, a good friend of mine, professor and director at the Fisheries Economics Research Unit at the University of British Columbia, who is the theme leader of the expert group on fisheries. And he'll be talking specifically about the policy options developed by the fisheries group, and in particular those related to fisheries subsidies, which of course is one of the items on the agenda for discussion in the Doha round. So after those two relatively brief presentations, we're going to have a group of discussants talk about what some of these policy options might mean in the context of the Doha round, both for Nairobi, but also beyond that. We have Abidun Chek, who is the Deputy Director of Fisheries and Trade at the Federal Department of Fisheries in Nigeria. It's a pleasure to have you, Abidun. We have Bipul Chatterjee, the Deputy Executive Director and Head of the Consumer Unity and Trust Society, or CUTS. And last but very definitely not least, we have Nicholas Mboden, who is the co-founder and partner at the Ideas Centre in Geneva. So each of these three people will provide a few brief thoughts in response to the policy options that are presented. Now, my job as chair is both a privilege and a challenge, because we have five experts who know these topics inside out. The wonderful thing about that is that it provides a basis for an extremely rich discussion on these policy options, but I'm also very conscious that the E15 experts and the E15 process, of which I've also been a part, has had a lot of time to talk amongst the experts about these policy options and what might be feasible. And one of our main objectives here is to make sure that we have enough time to provide discussion and input from you guys, from policymakers, from civil society, from academics, from people in the broader community. So the speakers have also been notified. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to sit down here as part of the audience. I'll give the floor to each of them in order, and when I stand up again, that is a slightly subtle hint that we need to move on to the next speaker. So everyone's on notice. I apologise in advance. I am going to have to be strict because it's very important to us to make sure that we get enough discussion with the broader group at this particular moment in the process. So with all of that lengthy introduction, Eugenio, we'd be delighted to hear from you.
Thank you very much, Alice. Thank you very much to ICTSD and the World Economic Forum and all the organizers and all of you for being here. I'm part of the E15 group working on agriculture and food trade, so I'll try to present some of the discussions. As Alice mentioned, it was just a free reflection on different the changing landscape at the world level and what policy options there may be, but we also were told not to get into the negotiation itself. So when I'm talking about new issues, I don't mean new issues in the sense of the discussions that we have right now. The outcome has been several discussion papers and then a personal synthesis by Stefan Dangerman on December 2013. And since then, certainly the world changed, and you could argue that perhaps we are seeing the same sort of 10-year arch that we saw in the 70s, you know, high prices, then low prices, and perhaps we are sort of playing out the same, history never repeats itself the same way, but it's sort of a lot of the components of the what happened in the mid-80s, it's sort of gathering together right now. But still some of the broad policy conclusions we think they are valid, so I'm gonna try to summarize those. We discussed basically within domestic support, the Annex II Green Box, that we have two different animals there. One basically are related to public goods. Another are income support. So the idea was to make sure that these two things are clearly separated and not put together in a single annex. And I would argue, in addition, that we didn't discuss at the time, but I think in income support, we need to separate that income support that is related to poverty-focused safety nets from income support in general. So we would have like three different levels: public goods, income support in general for farmers, and then income support related to poverty issues, and I'll get back to that. The other issue that we discussed was the potential of more better disciplines on export restrictions, export bans, export taxes, and so on. And we thought that it was also important for the exporters to make sure that they give assurances to the importers that they were not going to be disruptions coming from the exporters, as it happened in 2008 and a little bit less in 2011. So the need for stronger disciplines, but also clarify it's possible to have restrictions to prevent and relieve critical shortages, so that needs to be clarified. And then the G20 proposal that was never approved within the WTO, which is exempt food aid and vulnerable countries from export bans. And finally, there was this debate about potential symmetry between export and imports, whether there may be a cap on export taxes, maybe be an export quota, in the sense that countries should not go below the normal export levels. But that's more fancy, if you want, and for the future. Then there was a lot of discussion about enhanced monitoring and surveillance. Of course, it could be possible to work from Annex M, although the only thing the Annex M in 2008 modalities is that it referred to a lot of instruments that are in that modalities and there may or may not be approved. But in general, the strengthened monitoring and surveillance capabilities can be worked from Annex M. Then the possibility of coordinating notifications within the agreement on subsidies and countervailing measures and the agreement on agriculture, that now some of them are separate, different formats, and so on and so forth. Then the other point is, within the WTO, basically the idea is to transparency and enhance information, if you want. But what about the analysis? Because from that information, what it may be important for the countries, for all the countries to understand, is what is the impact of those, of course, that of those measures. And that would not be for the WTO to do, but certainly it's something that may be done by independent bodies, analytical research, universities, and so on. And finally, the other point that was raised is the possibility of giving incentives to have a more timely communications and information about policies using the stick of not being able to use an exemption. And if you call something that is a green box, then it would be accepted as a green box only if you have a strong, a clear notification that allows that assessment to be made. The other big area that now is even more relevant because of COP21 is what the coordination between the WTO and environmental rules. There are two issues, the first two related to biofuels that are unrelated to COP21, or are related but are separate and parallel to COP21, which is the better notifications on biofuels and the possibility of having disciplines on the levels of support on biofuels. But then the other question is very relevant for COP21. If you are following some specific policies related to your commitments under COP21, and that may lead to what is called carbon leakage, or that because of your industry less, or sector is less competitive because of the regulations, can you, under WTO rules, impose some border measures to compensate, to make sure that there are some balance between the environmental measures and what is happening in your trading partners. So that's there is a nice paper by David Blanford on that. We just were asking the questions and not necessarily answering them, but I think it's important to clarify those rules. And this is my last slide, the need, SPS implementation is crucial, but not because of, you know, trade. It's important to have a very strong SPS framework within developing countries for your own sake, for the sake of your own production, for the sake of the health of your own people. And then the point was to strengthen the support, the financial support and technical support for countries. There were some other aspects of food policy that I'm not going to go through all of them, really recognizing the importance of increasing productivity and incomes in agricultural sector in developing countries. And there was this potential issue related to whether markets are competitive or not in a lot of machinery, seeds, farm inputs, and whether competition policies may be part of that analysis. And finally, there was this suggestion of having a financial solidarity mechanism, which is if, according to the OECD data that covers not only OECD countries, but several emerging countries, now the PSC, the producer support equivalent, is about $500 billion. So if a fraction of that is used to, so if the countries that are giving support to their own farmers, developed and emerging, big emerging countries, that above a certain income level, can use a percentage to support poor producers in poor countries, then that financial solidarity mechanism could help to develop agriculture in developing countries. And that's the funding part, but then how to use it, and then the possibility of using a global food stamp program. Tim Joslin had a paper on under ICTSD on the global food stamp program, which it's an old idea in 1980s was discussed. And I would argue that probably more generally, you need an income support and poverty-based income support mechanism at international level. I did some calculations, and with about $50 billion, you could move all the population with perfect targeting, all the population that is under one, the lowest new poverty line, which is 1.9 something, you can move it above 2. And you calculate the gap, you multiply by the people, and then by the 365 days, and it gives you around $55 billion. That's less than 0.06%, less than 0.1% of the world GDP, and that could help with basically eliminating at least the level of indigence at the developable, as, again, with perfect targeting. There are some other calculations done by the World Food Program, FAO and IFAD in a recent document. Also, ILO has some calculations. But I think the possibility of this condition, this cash transfer that focused on the poor at the world level, I think would be what we believe that was something that can really eliminate poverty and hunger in the years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Eugenio. I didn't even need to stand up. Rashid, would you like to come next? And I'm already hearing a lot of connections, I think, between some of the ideas that have been discussed in the agriculture group and the fisheries group. So please, come ahead.
Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for the invitation. It's always good to get to share the work that we have done. Alice, can you promise me something? Will you give me the 2 minutes you save for you? I need a little more time. Okay. Okay. So the first point I want to make is that fish are really important to people, and I think many people in this room know that. We take out about 120 million fish cows, as I like to, a year from the ocean. If you convert the weight of fish we take, it's about 120 million cows globally. So that's a lot of food security for you. So fish is important. And unlike diamond and oil, fish is renewable. So if we do it properly, we can continue to eat fish through time, not only for us, but our future generations. It's more valuable than diamond if you think about it that way. Now, second point, fish is under threat, you know. Overfishing is big. FAO says about a third of our fish are already overfished, and that is a very conservative estimate, actually. So some scientists who are giving higher numbers. Okay, that's the second point. Now, the silver lining here for trade people is that fish is one of the most, in fact, it is the most traded agricultural commodity in the world. 37-40% of all the fish you catch is traded. Compared to rice, only 5%. So that means there is a lot of leverage here. You can use trade measures to try to do something. And this was what created our E15 Oceans and Fisheries Aspect Group. The idea that we can use trade to help. Okay? So that's my title. But actually, this talk is only an invitation to you to read our material. There's lots of material, many weeks of discussion, so I cannot give you that. Given the time, I'm just going to drop a few things, and hopefully that will give you the appetite to look for our papers on the web. We have think tanks, background papers. We're even doing a special issue of a journal. Marine Policy will soon publish some of our work. So that's that. Having said that, now I get to start with the real talk. Gosh, you got the old one, right? In here. So this is what I summarized to you so quickly because of time, okay? So, this is here. This is about the food security thing I mentioned. We can talk about this. You can get me after this. I can give you lots of numbers. This is the threat I mentioned. And because of that, we are catching about the same with a lot of effort. Every economist will tell you this is crazy. That means we are not getting anything for the extra fishing effort. And the reasons, there are many reasons for this, but two big ones are illegal fishing and subsidies, right? Illegal fishing is bad for the fish and bad for us because in the first place, it makes it difficult for us to manage the fisheries well. If you don't know how much you're taking, you cannot plan for the future. That's one example of that. So illegal fishing, and it's big, as I will show you. Subsidies encourage people to go fishing even when they wouldn't make money without them, so they're bad. It just pushes more capacity. And this is a quick summary of our take. A few years back, we collected data on where illegal fishing is taking place. And you can see it's all over the world virtually, only New Zealand. And if you look there, New Zealand, there's no bubble. But maybe they're good at hiding the data, right? So we don't know. But that tells you this is happening. And this is also because of economic incentives. It pays to go to fish illegally. Number one, nobody will catch you. There's poor monitoring and control. And number two, even when you are caught, most of the time, the penalty is almost nothing. In South Africa, they had problems a few years back. They catch an illegal fish and the courts would say, what has the man done? He just went fishing, go home, right? So the penalty and the detection is very important. The economic incentives actually encourage this thing. So I wouldn't tell you much about we had at least, at one point we had 17 recommendations. I'm only going to talk about three of them here. And I'm going to talk only about the subsidies. Illegal fishing comes only where it is related to subsidies, just to caveat. So in terms of the policies, our group, we agreed that the best thing for the world is to have a multilateral agreement where every maritime country is part of it. That is the way to deal with this. This is a global problem. But given all the frustration, years of effort, 10 years plus, WTO hasn't achieved anything, we went into the thinking that to try to find ways we can get movement. And some of the recommendations are based on that. So how can you start to get movement that will ultimately lead us to that multilateral agreement that we would prefer? Now, before I go to that, this is the subsidies data for you from one of our recent publications. It is big. We're talking about $35 billion of money. Your tax money is being given to the fishing sector by your governments. 35% is almost about 30% of the gross revenues of the fishery. Think about that. If you're doing a business and somebody is giving you 35% of your revenue, you are in good shape, right? Wouldn't you want that, madam? So that's what they get, 35%. That's huge. It encourages a lot of overfishing. That is what we call capacity-enhancing subsidies. Not all subsidies are bad. If a subsidy helps you to manage your stocks sustainably, that is generally good. Monitoring, control, surveillance, research, and things like that. But the bulk of it, 60%, according to our latest estimate, of the subsidies given are capacity enhancing. They encourage more subsidies. So this is big. This is the point I made about trade being a channel, because a lot of fish is traded, okay? You don't have time, okay? This is a picture of our team, which I didn't plan to show, but that's okay. And now we get to the three key recommendations I thought I should share with you. Remember, our preference is multilateral. Multilateral is difficult. So how do you get movement? And one of the things we discuss is to have a core group of countries adapt fisheries subsidies, you know, as a starting point. So if we can have, and when we did this, it was a discussion in the TPP, and now it has become a reality, there are some provisions there. So that is the kind of thing we're talking. These are 12 countries that have come together, and they're putting some provisions. We can argue about how good they are, how comprehensive, but there's something. And our hope is that that could be a catalyst, as I'll show you at the end. So that's one of our recommendations. Second one, establish multilateral disciplines that are built stepwise and from the bottom up. And I think the climate agreement is exactly what we are thinking here. We try to do from the top and it doesn't work. So ask countries, what are you willing to give up in order to help the whole world get a better fishery? And then we get that. And once you have the total, there's a gap, we'll find how to fill that gap, right? So that is the whole idea when we talk about people and groups that can help push the thing, and NGOs are big on this, civil society, intergovernmental organizations. Then establish multilateral disciplines built on areas of agreement in the WTO. In the last chair's text, there were issues that most countries agreed needed to be dealt with. So our question is, how about starting from this? If we all agree this subsidy is bad, we all agree to take it, we take that. Just put things in the bucket as you go in order to build momentum. So that is the idea. Now, what I'm going to do in my last few minutes is to go back to the TPP provisions, tell you what it is. Some of you know this already, but I will just the key provisions and then make some comments and we go. So these are the key core subsidies provisions. I say core because in addition to this, they actually have other provisions. Like, for example, don't give any more harmful subsidies. Just hold things as they are. They have certain provisions. But these are the core ones. That is in Article what? Something point 5, okay? So no party shall grant or maintain any of the following subsidies. And there are two of them. Subsidies for fishing that negatively affect fish stocks that are in an overfished condition. So two key conditions there. should be overfished, and the subsidy should negatively affect them, right? So that's the first one. And the second one is provide subsidies to IUU fishing vessels. You know, that's all the provisions in there. It's a good start from my point of view, given all the effort we have all put in, and there's nothing on the table, there's something. But then, here, my main issue here is implementation. How do you do this? How do you measure when the fish is overfished, right? Which countries do this? I know the U.S. do this each year. They do whether you are overfished or overfishing or what, and they have a state, so you could use that. But which other country? I don't know of any. Maybe the EU. So that is a big thing. Are you fishing? How do you fish them out, the illegal ones? There may be ways, but that is that's something for us to think about as we go through. For subsidies not covered by fire, each party shall make best effort to refrain from introducing new or extending or enhancing existing subsidies. So it's kind of a freeze thing. Okay, you are giving this, don't add more of the bad thing, right? Just stay there until we find ways to do this. So these are the main ones, and I thought I should share. Now, if we agree that this is at least some movement, what can this be? And from my thinking on subsidies, you know, the implementation is a problem, but as I said, I feel this is better than what we have or the status quo. And my hope is that this could catalyze action. So what I did here is to take data from our latest estimate of subsidies and try to build up and say, what happens if this leads to more action? For example, the top bar there is the TPP countries, their total subsidies, and the classification for them, good, bad, ugly subsidies, right? So if you look at that, that is more than $10 million, right? $10 billion, actually. Those are billion dollars. Sorry for that. $10 billion, which is, you remember I said it's $35 billion in total. So the TPP alone is about a third of global subsidies. If they're able to do something useful, that is good. China is, how about if China joins? And that will increase the total. And then you have the build-up. Let's say you have, there are other countries that are already showing interest in joining, then if they enter, we cover more of the world. If the EU, for example, through the TTIP, Europe and the US, agree to deal with this, then you have a bigger portion of the global total. So the chair is up, and I'm really close, and I already asked her for 2 minutes, and she didn't deny that. Thank you very much for your attention.
I don't think we could have planned that transition any more smoothly.
Yeah,
well done, Rashid. Thank you very much. I also thought I'd mention that Ambassador Gustavo Vanerio from Uruguay is on his way, but he's stuck in traffic. He sends apologies in advance, but he will be here very soon. So when he arrives, we'll incorporate him seamlessly into the speakers list. But we will proceed because it's important, I think, to get a few extra discussant ideas on the table before we open up the discussion to the audience as well. I'm going to call first on Abiyun Cheke, and we'd be really interested, Abiyun, in your responses specifically to the fisheries policy options, given that that's your particular background. If you have additional points on the agriculture stuff, that would also be interesting. But please go ahead, the floor is yours, and I'll pass you this microphone for ease.
Good morning, everybody.
Sorry, just hold it.
Good morning, everybody, yeah. Well, I'm a fisheries person, so anything about fisheries cannot be overlooked where I'm concerned. I quite agree with most of what Professor Rashid Sumaila said. However, we know that multilateral agreements often take time, and at the end of the day, we do not come to any conclusions. When you talk of TPP, if we name, like in Nigeria, for example, the countries put out there, I will not mention any country, they know themselves. They are the ones that come to our waters, IEZ, to do this IUU fishing. So, we must start from them. They should be the ones to voluntarily leave the waters. They know that developing countries We don't have much financial resources to do this thing. When you go into multilateral agreements, I take the WTO for example, it's taking some 10 years. 10 years of Doha round, and we still have not come to anything. We can get rid of IUU fishing through regional organizations. The regional organizations like the ACP countries, ECOWAS, ATLAFCO can come together, put their resources together, have a common front to fight IUU fishing and fishery subsidies. It doesn't often take place in developing countries. Fishery subsidies prevent the exports of developing countries from entering the markets of the EU countries, for example. So this should be a deterrent. We will not support any fishery subsidy that prevents our products from entering the EU, from entering other countries. Also on IUU fishing, we can even start domestically to prevent, because it's not only other countries that come to our waters to do the IUU fishing. We also have IUU fishing within the operators in the national country. So countries that have not domesticated some of the multilateral agreements and laws like the post-state measures, I believe they can start the domestication before we even go into multilateral agreements. Why don't we start from home, repair our own backgrounds, put in the necessary legislation, and maybe ask for support to strengthen our MCS and the VMS system? Because if a maritime country, I believe if we have a good monitoring, control, and surveillance system, we will be able to reduce IUU fishing. But right now, most of us, we don't have a serious MCS put in place, and the poachers come whilst we are sleeping and take away the resources. Then, well, efforts should be made to support the WTO to hasten the Doha rounds, and then let's move forward the multilateral agreements. If we can move forward, if we know those that would implement the TPP, some of those countries that have been pointed out by Prof, they are the ones doing the IUU. A lot of them are doing the peer trawling in our waters, and peer trawling destroys the habitats. And if you now say they should be the implementers of TPP, I don't think we can get anywhere in solving IUU. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Abiodun. I'm going to turn next to Bipul. Bipul, you are extremely familiar both with the WTO and the general trade system. And what's interesting, I think, about a lot of the fisheries, but also the agriculture context, is that we now, as Abiodun was saying, have the Trans-Pacific Partnership. We have some progress, at least on the fisheries subsidies element. But this raises a lot of interesting coherence questions. What do you do when the multilateral negotiations have failed to reach agreement, but you have some progress made in a regional trade agreement? So any thoughts you'd like to provide on either the fisheries, in particular the agriculture policy options, would be welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Alice. How much time I have? 8 minutes. Good morning, everybody, and let me begin by thanking ICTFT for the E15 initiative, and as usual for organizing the Trade and Development Symposium during the WTO ministerials. I think this is the ICTFT is doing this for a number of ministerials by now. I am privileged to be a part of the E15 initiative, and I've learned a lot from experts like Yuenyu and others. I contributed a paper on trade and food security, which I co-authored with Sophia Murphy, and I acknowledge her contribution in writing this paper. Sophia is present here, so let me first acknowledge her contribution in writing that paper. I think what I'm going to do is to respond to some of the points that Ivanio has made in his presentation. But I will also, I'm not an expert on fisheries, but so it will be difficult for me to talk about fisheries, but I'll end up with just one comment after hearing from real experts who are working on fisheries. Now, E15 initiative, as I understand, is to look at various policy options to improve global agriculture regime in the context of trade. And those policy options were discussed beyond the current context of negotiations in the WTO, which I think is a good initiative, a good approach, because we often tend not to think much while talking everything, all issues in negotiating terms. I particularly like the point, the first point that Ivanio has made, that we need to see the strong linkages that food security and sustainable development goals that we have. And here, what I would like to underline is that food security should be looked at as a sovereign right and also as a public good, as UNEO and many other experts in the E15 initiative, they have rightly articulated. So it is in this context we need to look at the various questions, or issues, challenges which are arising while discussing food security and the linkages between trade and food security. I'll come back to this point towards the end of my presentation. Now, on stronger disciplines on export restrictions, I completely agree with the options which were put forth by UNU and other colleagues of the E15 initiative. Because in our work, we have found in on export restrictions put by India, and India is, there are a number of export restrictions that India put from time to time, particularly on food crops, including sometimes on cash crops. We have found that not only that the impact on our producers, producer welfare is negative as a result of such restrictions, but also, and obviously the impact on consumer welfare in importing countries is also negative, but also there is no, absolutely no impact, but sometimes negative impact on our own domestic consumers. So the decisions on export restrictions, on food items in particular, and also on cash crops, I think is fairly, very political, and most of the time, if not all, they are knee-jerk reactions which the policymakers and politicians take while addressing domestic constituencies. Then the next question is, and which is in the context, also in the context of current discussion which is taking place in the WTO and also in this ministerial, my question is that I think we need to decouple the issues relating to export restrictions and export subsidies. These are two different issues. And I think at the moment, other than having stronger disciplines on export restrictions, we also need to have some decisions on export subsidies. And also, I'll come back to this point sometime later on. I also agree with various points that Ivanio has presented on monitoring and surveillance, particularly impact analysis. And here, in the context of impact analysis, I would like to link it with the demand that India and many other developing countries are making on public stock holding for food security purposes. So we have this public stock holding program which is going on. I think there is a legitimate concern that India has put forward, India and many other developing countries have put forward. But at the same time, we need to see their impact, how it is helping our domestic food security. Obviously, of course, it is helping our domestic food security, but we need to see the impact more in terms of real-time data and things like that. And maybe we can also go a little beyond to see not just food security, but also nutrition security for our domestic consumers, particularly domestic consumers. Now, I'll not go into much details on other points that UN has presented. I agree with him that what he found that we, at least in a country like India, farm productivity is closely linked with various anti-market competitive distortions which are there in our domestic market. Whether it is seed market or fertilizer market, whether it is on the input side or other inputs, or on the logistics side, the distribution side, so there are so many anti-competitive market distortions which are taking place. That actually is not only having negative impact on our farm productivity, but also our farmers are not getting better price, they are not getting, not unable to market their products properly. So that definitely needs to be looked at very, very carefully. Now, here I would also like to point out that while there is absolutely a need to increase farm productivity, they also have to be linked with proper pricing policy and proper marketing policy. Otherwise, it will be very difficult, and that is what is happening in our country. It will be very difficult for our farmers to invest in their agriculture to improve their farm productivity. So we need to look at this issue in a more holistic manner, not just to improve the yield or farm yield, but also marketing and pricing of their products. As on domestic support for food security in poorest countries, I think this is a very good idea. And also global food stamp program, I think it's again a very good idea. How are we going to take this forward? That is something the international community, the trade community, and also the food security community, they need to look at. Now I will come to the end of my presentation by making four very brief remarks. First is, while all these options are very good, I am not sure how, in the current political context, I am not very sure how they can be taken forward in the WTO. I am not very sure, let me pose a question. I am not very sure that, can we apply the critical mass or multilateral approach to negotiate agriculture issues? I think that will be very, very difficult to apply that approach to negotiate agriculture issues. Secondly, it will be very interesting to see, to do some rigorous analysis, how these options are treated in our, are treated or are being treated or will be treated in mega regionals, in TPP, in TTIP, and also in other mega regionals like regional comprehensive economic partnerships. And very briefly, I'm not going to discuss or say anything about what is happening in Nairobi or what is likely to happen. But finally, it is interesting for me, at least for me, to note that if there can be certain disciplines on fisheries subsidies in the TPP, why can't we have such disciplines on ag subsidies in the multilateral context and also in the regional context? So thank you very much once again for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Bipul, and I think you've left us with precisely the right questions for the next discussion. But before we move on to that, Nicholas, you've had a lot of experience, both in working in the WTO and with countries on their own domestic and regional trade policies. And a lot of these questions, I think, are both technical questions and political questions. We have some progress in regional trade agreements on really important sustainable development issues that are under negotiation in the WTO. We have, you know, not much progress in those regional trade agreements on other specific issues like agriculture subsidies. Can you help us understand, sort of once you've responded very briefly to the policy options, but can you help us understand a little bit kind of the political dynamic between the multilateral and the regional aspects and answer some of these questions? It's the $64 million question, I know, but if anyone can answer it, I think you probably can. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you very much, and thank you for organizing this meeting. I don't know much about fisheries, so I'm not going to talk much about fisheries, so I do like fish. But I just wanted to make two remarks, actually one that follows what also people said. you know, if we are able to make an advancement, at least on IUU in the TPP, and probably also now in the TTIP or in the future TTIP, it seems to me very strange that we are unable to do that within WTO. And this might be also a way of showing, you know, how regional or mega deals can actually be a help to get in the multilateral, provided they are in the same spirit, which seems to be the case. And that might be a positive element for once of these mega deals. The second one I wanted to make a little remark is about what Madame Cheke said about the importance and the monitoring, you know, of the fish stocks, you know, the help that you need to get. It's very, very complicated because that's the only experience I have with fisheries. We were asked when I was working for a private company to help Senegal to monitor, you know, the fishing, and we had to abandon it because basically you need an army to protect you to monitor it. And so it's a very big issue which I don't think you can actually solve at the country level. You do need to get the help of the IUU countries who are fishing in those areas. And that also shows, you know, I think the importance of the sanctions, you know, which are, as was said beforehand, you know, completely ridiculous to fight against IUU. But let me now come to what I'm really supposed to talk about. My 5 minutes only start now. And that is, you know, what does this thing mean for the countries that I am interested in, which means actually the poorer countries, the poor developing countries, and in particular the LDCs. You know, I am appalled, quite frankly said, that we have negotiated in WTO for 14 years about agriculture, and there is not one proposal on food security on the table. And quite frankly said, I know that some people will object to this because there's the G33 proposal on stockpiling, but I do not believe that this is a food security proposal for the poorer countries. It is a proposal that helps some countries that have the institutional and financial capacity to have stocks. But most of the poorer developing countries do not have that capacity. And as a matter of fact, the flexibilities they have to do what is required for food stocking, they already have, and they don't use it fully. So giving more flexibilities to countries that they cannot use is not very useful. And LDCs and poor developing countries have a big food security problem, really for two reasons. Most of them, if not all, are net food importers, and actually they are part of the food that they have to import to survive. The population is increasing substantially. And secondly, they are all in climatic difficult zones. I mean, they have regular calamities. And as we all know from the change in the climate, you know, these calamities are going to increase both in frequency and in severity. So food security is a big issue for those countries and has to be addressed. Now, one of the reasons, what does it really mean, food security for those countries? It's that basically those countries, or most of them, not all, but most of them, have a lot of resources in agriculture. I mean, they have quite plenty of land, they have plenty of labor, and they could actually develop their, they could produce their own products. And that's why many of those countries have adopted self-sufficiency rules. I don't think this is the best way, quite frankly said, because of the calamities that I was talking about. And secondly, because what you want, I mean, food security is really two elements. One is food availability, and the other one is to have the money to buy the food if you need it. So what you need to do is you need to give the money or the capacity of the people to be able to buy the food if they don't produce it themselves. So basically, what you have a great capacity to increase productivity and production in those countries, which solves the issue of availability and the issue of affordability for those countries. And I think, as people said before, you know, increasing productivity is more than just giving technology. You have to give access to markets, and you have to help people to be able to use the resources that they have. Basically, what they need is capital, technology, and information on markets. And that is, when you have a farmers, most farmers in the countries that we are talking about are small farmers. And they are basically producing at close to the near self-sufficiency level. Because they want to make secure that their families can survive. If you want them to increase the productivity, they have to specialize, they have to produce for the market. What this means is they take a risk in terms of the food security of their own population, of their own family. And I'm not crazy. If I'm a farmer and the farmers are not crazy, I'm not going to take the risk to make a little more money, you know, this year when the prices are good or when my returns are good, and then next year to have my family living in hunger. So they take a risk if they produce the markets, and we have to reduce that risk. And there, they need a fair international environment. And today's international environment is not fair for them in agriculture. There are clear and simple measures that anybody can take today for those countries that would greatly help them to have a policy of agricultural production that is not self-sufficiency, but that is in line with their comparative advantage. And that would increase the revenue and the income of those poor farmers that are at the margin of the survival. Now, what is this? Basically, I think the international, we have two things. We need stable prices that the farmer gets. That does not mean price controls, because price controls are bad, simply because they give the wrong signals over the long term, and they are very difficult to change. But what it means is we have to reduce the price volatility for the farmer. Oh my God. Sorry. Secondly, they need a fair environment in their market, and they need to limit the risk. So I will go very quickly now, because I'm getting angry looks there. Is first of all, from an international environment, those farmers need to be able to sell their products in their market fair. That means they have to have means to fight against subsidies from the north and from the emerging countries. Whether they are green, yellow, pink, it doesn't matter the color. They need to be able to have a fair chance on their market. That means they have to have the right to put on variable levels of levies on countries that support the product. Secondly, they need to be able to export their products on a market on fair conditions. There's no way you can exclude subsidies for LDCs or poorer countries on the international market. But there comes the solidarity proposal from the things. You can tax the PSI of countries that export and distribute that money according to the part of the international market that those countries have. Mm. Thirdly, they need a means to take account of the price volatilities by having the right to put a tax on the projects on a certain level when the prices decrease more than a certain percentage every year, or when the price increase over a certain percentage to subsidize it with the solidarity fund that was made. A system like that would allow those countries to be able to have an international environment that allows them to increase their productivity. Now, the last question that you asked me is, what does that have to do with the regional integration? Mm-hmm. I have nothing against regional integration, certainly not if it's a regional integration. I have a problem with mega deals, because mega deals will attack the issues of the big countries. They will not attack the issues of food security of the LDCs. Mm. So what we need is, if you want a plurilateral or whatever you want, system where we address the issues of the poorer net food importing countries, where they are getting what they need in terms of the international environment, but also where they are doing something by taking commitments in a value chain approach to the increase of production. Mm. And that is the last proposal that they made, is that you are also increasing the competition for the inputs, for the credit, for the extension service, the research in the countries. Mm. And such a new deal would show that everybody is willing to collaborate together and each one takes its responsibilities. Mm. Sorry for being long.
Not at all. Thank you, Nicholas, very much indeed. So do we need a new deal? What would the new deal look like? And I think we have a lot of really interesting ideas from the policy options that suggest, you know, where could we go forward, both in the WTO and outside. But you've all been extremely patient. I've done my best to keep us to time, but you've all been very, very patient. We have a fantastic panel of experts and some really interesting ideas on the table. What I'm going to do is to collect two or three questions and then offer the panel the opportunity to answer them and then come back for another two or three. That way, hopefully, we'll get through as many ideas as possible. So it's over to you. The floor is open. I have one, two, and three in the back. Go ahead, please. Yes. Oh, here's your microphone.
Okay, thank you. Yes, excuse my poor English. Okay. I am here on behalf of ROPA, the network of regional farmers from West Africa. Mm. And they have just issued an interesting booklet on how, on the same issue of let us dare to reform the WTO for food sovereignty. Mm-hmm. So just let us remind that the GATT Article 6 and the anti-dumping agreement Article 1 mm-hmm. is at the source of the change in the agricultural policy in the launching of the Uruguay round, because at that time the US and the EU said, oh, because the anti-dumping agreement is saying that there is no dumping as long as you are exporting at the same price as the domestic price. Mm-hmm. So this induced the EU and the US to lower a lot their guaranteed minimal prices to compensate them by so-called non-trade distorting subsidies, because the two also devised the rules of the agreement on agriculture. Mm-hmm. They revised their policy. And because once having reached the top of the ladder of agricultural competitiveness with decades of large subsidies, large import duties. Mm-hmm. And the, you know that the US even get a waiver from the GATT in 1955 to be able to tax any product will go against their own agricultural laws. Mm. So,
would you like to put question, a specific question? Go ahead.
Yes,
my
question is, we should allow the poor countries to follow the same ladder. That is, as you rightly, Mr. Imboden said, to be able to protect their own agricultural product, mm-hmm. performers, through variable levies, mm-hmm. which not only will put will prevent imported product to enter, but which also will prevent any exchange.
Okay, and I think this speaks a lot to the food security question. Exactly, what is it that developing countries of various income levels should be doing to achieve this?
Should be allowed to use the same tools as the EU and the US used before the WTO?
And that's a perfectly clear question and really helpful for the debate. Thank you. I'll take this. I'm in the front. Go ahead, please, and then we'll get to you.
I need more. I guess I'm more clarification. I'm Chris Raggi from the University of Northern Iowa, which everybody in the world knows is agriculture, right? My question is about the fisheries. When you guys are talking about IUU and the whole aspect, are you talking about the natural waterways that we have in the world, or are you including fish farms in those regulations that you're talking about? Mm. It wasn't clear to me.
Mm. But a very clear question. Thank you. In the back.
Thank you. I'm Wei from Bambalan Bellies. I have two questions. The first question goes to Nicholas. You are talking about food security and the two dimensions of the availability and affordability. But there is another dimension which is really important, is food safety. Now there is a lot of GMO issue or is overuse of chemicals, and this do cause a lot of concerns for not only developing countries, for the whole human being. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with this concern? Mm-hmm. That's the first question. The second question is fishing. From the institutional perspectives, there are a lot of international or regional management organizations, as you mentioned, and they are mainly responsible for sustainable management, sustainable fishing, or monitoring, or fighting against IUU fishing. How did the international trade community coordinate with those kind of regional management organizations? Thank you.
Fantastic. Two extremely good questions. So I think we have a variety of questions there, both on the agriculture and the fisheries side. Rashid, shall I start with you on fisheries? And then I might come to Nicholas and perhaps Eugenio and Bipul if you'd like to speak about agriculture. Rashid, go ahead.
Yeah, so the number of questions. I want to start actually with the comments from Abiodun, Sister Abiodun here, and then link up to that. You made a number of interesting comments, and the one I noted, two of them. One is, why would the countries, the big countries that come to fish in West Africa, for example, illegally, that they should voluntarily stop this? I think that's a very interesting concept, right? I mean, it would be nice if they do that. I kind of like it, and I'm thinking, how do we get this to work? You know, usually countries don't just, most of the time, they don't just do what is good for other people. They have to be pushed. And in many instances, it's locals within the country, within civil society people who push them. And another thing that could be done is to name and shame countries. You know, there's a whole literature about that. You cannot just beg people to just do the right thing. You have to, economic incentives. So naming and shaming could be one of the ways. Your second point was developing countries really give very little subsidy, and that is true. Actually, it's on one of my slides, but they went so fast, I don't think any one of you saw that. Of the total subsidy, 65% is given by developed countries and 35% by developing countries. If you do that in proportion of the total fish take, that is a 1:7 proportion. So developed country fishers get 7 times more subsidies to lift 1 ton of fish than developing countries. So your point is well valid. Last year I gave a talk in Addis Ababa, and I told them, Africans, developing country people, you should be jumping on the roof saying we don't want these subsidies because you are the ones who suffer most from them. So that was, you touched on that nicely. Then our data is not about farm fish at all, it's about marine fish. This is fish in the ocean mainly, okay? Then food safety is very, very important. Agriculture, you know, there's a lot about all the things they pump in, the bio stuff to deal with disease, which has consequences. Big tunas are taking lead and so on in the ocean. So that's a big issue, and there are people working on that. More needs to be done, I think. Institutional, regional management organizations, in our reports and in our options, we really have portions where we say who and who can help the world achieve this option. And they do appear in those options. We cite the regional management organizations as some of the parties we need to be able to get some movement. So, yeah, thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Rashid. Perhaps I'll turn then to Nicholas first in response for some of the agriculture questions, and then to Eugenio and to Bipul if you'd like to. Nicholas?
Thank you. I promise to be short. No, first of all, you know, concerning the right of the poorer countries to protect their agriculture like the rich countries do, I don't like that approach. I don't think they should be allowed to do the silly things that we did. That's not the right approach. But I do hope that they can protect in a variable way, you know, but following the market trend of their farmers. You know, it's not a question of getting fixed prices, it's a question of avoiding that you get a volatility that they cannot support. I think the concept is different. On food safety, clearly is a big issue, but in many countries, you know, that I'm talking about, the smaller countries, it's not that a big issue yet, because the food chain is much shorter, you know. I mean, you buy more locally, and therefore you know what you buy, and what comes in is normally actually has gone through the controls in the originating countries. But all of the countries that I know that enter into the market in a more substantial way put a heavy weight on putting up to ensure food security. Thank you.
Perhaps there's another facilitator in the room. Eugenio, would you like to respond very quickly on some of those comments? And then Bipul, if you'd like to. Eugenio.
Thank you very much, Ali. Is it this on? Yeah.
Well, first, also thank you very much for the comments. I participated in Uruguay round as diplomat for my own country, which is Argentina. And I thought it was always good, three basic principles. One is you do not ask what you already have. And unfortunately, sometimes countries, developing countries, are asking things that they already have, and they are paying a price in negotiation because of they already have that. Second, you do not ask what you cannot use because you don't have the money or technical capabilities. And third, you do not ask something just because other people have it, because that may be good or not. So basically, you need to analyze everything that you want as a negotiator in terms of the interest of your own country. And I feel that sometimes developing countries are not following any of these three rules. Example, general services, absolutely unnecessary. What it was negotiated in Bali, that was absolutely already covered in the Annex 2. But developing countries pay a price for asking something that you already have. Well, so that's one point. Second point, the issue of protection variable levies stability. The first thing we need to understand is what is protection. Protection is a tax on food that is collected by the private sector, mostly by large producers, and is, in percentage terms, mostly paid by poor people relative to their own income. And I'm not against a tax per se. The question is then what I'm getting out of that tax. If you want protection to stabilize the price internally, that may be okay, but then research by IFPRI showed that, for instance, in Africa, the countries that intervene to stabilize prices have more volatility in domestic prices than the world volatility. So basically, it doesn't mean that the fact that you can intervene will stabilize prices. Different is Asia. Let's say Indonesia. Okay, rice is 50% now, it was 56% of calories. One single crop, rice. They do not have macroeconomic instability, therefore stabilizing rice made sense for Indonesia. But let's say Latin America, you have variety of products, so are you going to stabilize all of them? And the basic instability comes from the macro side, not from the agricultural sector. So you need to look at the specific conditions in each country. Finally, I would argue that, you know, you usually have three objectives. You know, one is efficiency. You want the market to operate properly. The other is equity, completely different. We know that markets will not give you equity. Equity is a separate discussion. Equity and then sustainability, which is sort of an equity, intergenerational equity, you know. If we can separate, I think it's a bad idea to look at food security in terms of crops. I look at food security in terms of people. So if I'm concerned about food security, I subsidize people. Because if I subsidize crops, may or may not help food security. So if you can call it food security crops, whatever, but they are not food security. The problem of food security or food insecurity happens at the level of people. So the best way, if you are concerned about that, subsidize people, and then you let and then you stabilize income and livelihoods. Mm. That's what I want to stabilize, not prices. I don't care about the price of crops. I care about the survival strategies of people. Mm. And that's a separate thing, and using prices to stabilize the livelihood of people, it's a long way separate in terms of policy interventions. Mm. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Eugenio. Bipo, go ahead. You can have one
microphone. Thank you. Before responding to these questions and some of the points that Eugenio, particularly one point that Eugenio has just made, let me respond to some of the points that Nicola has made just now. It is indeed surprising that there is not even a single proposal on food security in poorest countries. It says many things, including our failure to take that responsibility and come out and help least developed countries to highlight their need for food security, domestic food security. And the question is why, despite being so resource rich, these countries are unable to produce more. I think, as you have rightly pointed out, it's because of market uncertainty in various forms. And in order to address those market uncertainties, what is needed, as UNO has just said, in the long-term price stability mechanism, number one, and also to adhere to fair market principles. And that is very much lacking in the current international trade regime and also domestic economic policy regime. Fair market principles are very much lacking. And therefore, I think, forget about attracting investment and all those things. I think food security, ensuring food security, particularly in poor countries, should be one of the most important objectives of a multilateral agreement on trade and competition policy. And that is something I think which we need to discuss more in the present context and also in future. I know that E15 has a working group on that subject, and they have done good work, and we also need to take forward that work. Now, coming to specific questions, I agree that we shouldn't do what European countries or United States they have done in 70s or 80s, including they continue doing many such things. Because I think, many of us simply do not have resources to do such things, and also there are so many distortions in the system that we may end up, as UNU has rightly pointed out, we may end up in protecting the interests of large business and large producers in the name of supporting poor farmers, and which is what is happening in the fertilizer case, in case of fertilizer subsidies in India. I mean, it's mainly the large business who are benefiting, including large business outside India, who are incidentally, some of them have also formed cartels. So these issues are all interlinked. On food safety dimension, I think, yes, you are absolutely right. That's one of the major dimensions of food security. And they are very much related to standards, both domestic standards and international standards. And I think this dimension is going, other than just availability of food and access to food, safety is going to become more and more important in future. And unfortunately, there's not much discussion on food safety dimensions neither at the regional trade level negotiations or nor at the multilateral level. But I think that is going to happen in future. Now, if I may just respond to, or let us say, that what could be the possible way forward on many of these issues. As we know that this, I don't have to go into the details and why Doha Round, particularly on agricultural issues, is not progressing and all those things. Can we not discuss without any prejudice for coming to or making commitments or coming to a conclusion? Can you not discuss these issues, at least some of them, in the WTO Committee on Agriculture? That's one of the questions that I would like to pose. And many of these issues, if we go deeper, are also part of the built-in agenda of the Uruguay Round Agreement on Agriculture. So the mandate is there. I think the need is there. We need to put pressure to our negotiators to discuss these issues, at least discuss them, if not make any commitments or if without any intention to come to a conclusion in near future.
Thank you very much indeed, Bipul. And I think that speaks to a really interesting question about the various functions of the WTO. It's not just a negotiating forum. It has extremely important institutional functions through its regular committee work, its dispute settlement functions, etc. So what are the roles perhaps for things beyond just the negotiating function and the implementation of the agreements and the committee discussion? Now, we have another 10 minutes or so I can take another round of questions. We have one here, one at the back, and you, sir. Go ahead, Sonia, and your microphone is coming.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Sophia. Thanks, Bipul, for the acknowledgement. It was a pleasure to work with E15. I just wanted to say, I think one of the big issues that I'm looking at around these discussions is trust. And it's really clear across the road how little trust there is. And so I think one of the institutional failures of the WTO, partly because of its dispute settlement, partly because of its trade negotiating function, is that it's not a very convivial or easy atmosphere in which to try out new ideas or in which to say, let me see if I do this for 3 years and then decide if I commit to it permanently. That kind of thing is not, hasn't been part of the culture and isn't easy to see in the culture. It's not encouraged even. Mm. And I think that either the WTO will be forced because it's unable to actually negotiate without more space for experiment, more space for idea and discussion. Mm. Either it's going to just keep on failing, or it needs to allow these discussions to be happening elsewhere, which is going to happen anyway. It's there in the SDGs if countries choose to take it up. It's happening in climate necessarily. There will have to be trade measures. Mm. And it could happen around the Committee on Food Security if governments allow it. They have there. Mm. But I would suggest for now the WTO has too little trust and that elsewhere might be where the governments need to take up these discussions and then begin to see what that would look like. I think the WTO will play a role, but I think they've backed themselves into a very, very small corner on what's possible. And I think a lot of food security measures aren't obvious. It's a complicated, messy business domestically, and it's complicated in the region, and it's much more complicated internationally. Mm. And to expect to negotiate with the US right now, for example, on food, it's just very hard to see how that will happen. Mm.
Thank you very much indeed, Sophia. Question at the back, James.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, it'll be James next. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, James.
James knows me well.
I am Sufyan Karuma from FAO. Maybe I need some clarity here. I mean, I'm taking off from Sophia that, I mean, most of the panelists are saying that there are no food security proposals. And maybe it is not as obvious, or maybe the issue is in implementing these proposals. Because from what we are seeing, there are a lot of proposals out there that have not been implemented. I mean, even the proposals on subsidy and export, domestic and export subsidy reduction is linked to food security. The JITA, the three proposal on safeguards and food stock holdings are linked to food security. The preferential rules of origin and duty-free tariff and quota-free for LDCs are linked to food security. So there are a whole host of proposals there. Maybe it is much more the implementation of those and getting, because they are much more good endeavor proposals. The Marrakesh decision is also strongly linked to food security. So maybe some clarity needs to be hashed out from this debate. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. No, that's an excellent question. So perhaps a bit more clarity. What do we really have on the table in the WTO on food security? And just before James speaks, I had just one comment to make, which is that we deliberately combined both the agriculture and the fisheries group policy options in this session because we felt very strongly that both of them related very closely to food security. Now, people don't talk about fisheries a lot in the food security context, but we specifically wanted to combine both of these discussions to try and bring out that linkage. So perhaps in answering this question, what's on the table for food security, we can think both about the agriculture proposals and the fisheries ones. Final question from James. Thanks. Go ahead.
Thank you, Alison. I'll make comments on both agriculture and fisheries. I'm struggling to find a question in my comments, so you'll excuse me.
Don't feel the need to disguise.
thank you for all the speakers, and apologies for arriving late. Firstly, on the TPP and fisheries, as Rashid pointed out, some of the significant elements, disciplines in that agreement. I mean, it's extraordinary that we have anything in a FTA on subsidies, whether it's fishery subsidies or anything at all. So I think that's something that really needs to be flagged. But as significant as it is, the glass is very much half full, and it's a very small glass. So we need to fill the glass by getting other members to other countries to be coming on board with these kind of disciplines, especially the big players, which includes the developing countries. And we need to have a bigger glass in terms of having broader disciplines because they are very bare-bone, minimal disciplines. So this really, I think, leads me to agree very much with the point made about the role of the WTO in this area. And I take the point made about the lack of trust in the WTO, and that is, I think that is a valid point, but it's difficult to see any other institution that can deliver in this area where you need legally binding disciplines. And we would hope that the MC10 this week can make a contribution to that end. But but it's certainly certainly not certain we'll have an outcome from the MC10 conference on fisheries subsidies, and there's a lot of political frustration around this, and so as a consequence, there'll be a group of members, over 20 members tomorrow, issuing a statement on fisheries subsidies, where they'll be talking about the need for future action in this area, but also undertaking commitments themselves on fisheries subsidies. That's a political type statement. So this all gives us a lot of optimism for the future. So to come on to agriculture, if I may, I think this really does highlight the question that was posed about, well, you can do fish subsidies in TPP, what about export subsidies? And I think that's a very good point. But we would hope that question becomes irrelevant, because again, we should be delivering on that this week. And that should really be doable, given it's only three countries spending export subsidies under scheduled commitments, like Norway, Canada, Switzerland. So, and that would be something significant for development in every sense. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much indeed, James. We have time for a very brief responses then from the panel. So I'm going to give you the flexibility to answer any three of those questions in whatever combination you'd like. I'm going to start with people, and then I'm going to move across the table like that. People, go ahead. Here's your microphone.
Thank you, Alice. On Sophia's point about trust deficit in the WTO, I think she is absolutely right, and there could be several reasons for why there is so much of trust deficit in the WTO. And Nicola is much competent to talk about that. But I think one possible reason could be that we haven't given, since when we started this Doha round of negotiations, I think, A, we have rushed through in launching a new round without giving enough emphasis on the built-in agenda in the Uruguay round agreements. And then we have neglected the committee work. In the WTO, we have given a lot of much more emphasis on negotiations, which is fine, but at the same time, we should have been more forceful in talking many of these issues in the regular committee work of the WTO. Perhaps that could have reduced the trust deficit among the members. And if I'm not mistaken, also there is a gap between Geneva and national capitals. And that could be another possible reason for trust deficit. I also agree with her that if we are not able to make progress on these issues at the WTO, then there are other platforms which are much more non-binding in nature, and we may make some progress on many other such platforms, including FAO, not just SDGs, through SDGs or through regionals, but including in FAO, I think, including at the UN level. And I also agree with the last point that we need to take a very closer look, or the second last point, we need to take a very closer look at the linkages between food security and livelihood aspects of trade. The work program on LDCs, the work program on SVEs, they are all focusing on the livelihood aspects through trade. And that has a, we shouldn't just think about food security from farmers' angle and also from non-farmers, consumers, particularly poor consumers. So that is something where I think much more work is needed. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. I think for fisheries, fish food security, international trade, and getting rid of IUU, the multilateral organization WTO needs to work more with the FAO and the regional bodies and other organizations like CITES, because most of the regional bodies work well with the FAO and with the CITES bodies. And if the WTO can key in into them, and also I feel where the WTO can be more recognized is in capacity building, especially for developing countries, and advocacy and awareness. If they are able to do this, they would have achieved something towards fishery subsidy and solving the IUU problems. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. First of all, about trust. WTO is not about trust. WTO is about interests. So, you know, let's go back to interests. You know, we are a mercantile institution. And the problem, I think, and that's the reason why there is not trust, that we forget about the interests. I very much like what Eugene said, that, you know, we are often actually talking out of ideological, it's a bad word, but principles rather than from the interests we have. And I think that's one of the problems we have now, no feeling, no trust among ourselves, because we are talking in terms that are no longer responding to the reality. I'm not a friend of the Americans. I'm on the list of the National Security Agency to be observed. So I have all the legitimacy not to be considered as a friend of the Americans. But I do agree with them that we are fighting the last war in the DDA. Everything is costed in questions of developing countries and developed countries. That's not the world today. If we look at the subsidies, you know, we do have subsidies now in the south, as much as in the north. So we got to look at those realities and defend the interests that we have. And that gives me to the second question on terms of the FAO, where they say there are a lot of proposals that have to do with food security. Absolutely right. But they are not expressed and identified as food security issues. Let's take the SSM. If we look at food security, the SSM would still exist, but would be another element than it is now. The SSM, the way it is made now, is a measure against developed countries from developing countries. And I think that's one of the problems. If we had a proposal of food security, which would include also fisheries, because it is an important element, I think we would have a much better case to defend the interests of those countries who consider, rightly, that the right to food is a human right. And we have not done that. The last thought is about subsidizing. What Eugene said is subsidize people, not crops. And I think he's right from a distributional aspect out. But if you want to increase the production of your countries, you got to make sure that the crop prices are providing an incentive for the farmer to produce. So you do have to put the two elements into the equation. Thanks.
So I've been thinking how to do this quickly. You know, implementation has been on our mind all through this. And you can see that as well. We're thinking about piecemeal ways of doing this. And you can see an example with TPP, like you said at the back, right? I mean, So implementation is crucial, and sometimes you have to take things down a little bit. There's a win and we build on it. And that is why some of us like the TPP progress, if you can call it that. At least you have something to work on. Now, on food security, we really have to make the connection to the ocean. Like I was trying to say, we take out about 120 million tons of fish. If you take out all the illegal and unreported catches, 120 million tons of fish a year. That is double all the cows in terms of weight that we get out of our farms. Somebody has to make this. I've already written the title of it.
We have to make this clear. And the thing is that... is that
do you have a last thought?
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Last thought.
This is still there. Okay. It's back. Okay, the last thought about subsidizing people. Just to give you some hope about this, I think Finland is actually having a referendum very soon to guarantee some minimum income for everybody in Finland. Mm-hmm. 1,200 euros a month, that's what they're doing. Geneva is thinking about that. In fact, Canada did that. In one city, they did that, and it was working very well. Until a conservative became the prime minister, it was shut down. So these are possibilities. Think about it.
Thank you.
No, I do not agree with the last point. I'm just going to comment on the export subsidies. The export competition. We just ran some simulations at IFPRI. We believe that we are going into a period of low prices, then export subsidies that now are not operational will become operational. So we were calculating, I don't know, probably it may go up to $11 billion. Of export subsidies. So I think it's very important to, and that is,
$11 million displaced in developing countries, because subsidies are mostly, export subsidies come from developed countries, displaced a little bit more of the same amount in terms of value added in agriculture. So it was a transfer to the consumer in poor developing countries, but it was also at the same time a displacement of production in developing countries. So, and then we ran another simulation, which is how can we, what amount of money is needed to get the same level of consumption in developing countries that comes from the export subsidies, but without displacing production. So giving a food stamp program. And in fact, with $6 billion, so about half of the amount of export subsidies, you could get the same level of consumption of the export subsidies, but without displacing production in developing countries. And in fact, everybody will be able to have a little bit more production because it's basically generating aggregate demand from people that would not otherwise have had that aggregate demand for food.
Thank you very much, Eugenio. This is, I guess, at the beginning of phase two of the 15 process. All right, I'll just speak up. This is the beginning of phase two of the 15 process. So our next steps from here will essentially be a continuation of this engagement with policymakers. So we, within the E15, have been talking a lot about the policy options, what's realistic and what would work. And the next process is essentially to start road testing these ideas properly with people like you. Does this really work? Is it feasible technically and politically? So look out on our website for the next few announcements and the next papers as they come out on the policy options. There'll also be a big launch in Davos next year of the full suite of the policy options, so look out for that as well. But we've already run slightly over time, so do very, very last thing, please join me in welcoming and thanking all of our panelists for their excellent work. Thank you very much.